In this edition of Art Loft, the Curator's Collection, Low Art Museum, featuring Attitudes and Latitudes.
I started to kind of see a red thread that was interesting to me, which was really about the connection between the artist and the landscape.
Writing between heaven and earth.
To try to read it. Actually, the American audience, they can read it. They can understand, oh, this is my language.
Annie Leibovitz.
There's homework to be done. You know, you learn about the subject, you learn about what they do, you find out as much as you can about them.
It's all ahead on this edition of Art Loft's The Curator's Collection.
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by...
In the Florida Keys and Key West, every night is a spectacular show. And every day is another masterpiece.
This project is sponsored in part by the Department of State, Division of Cultural Affairs, the Florida Council of Arts and Culture, and the State of Florida. With the support of the Miami-Dade County Department of Cultural Affairs and the Cultural Affairs Council, the Miami-Dade County Mayor, and the Board of County Commissioners. With the support of the City of Coral Gables.
Hi, I'm Kaylin James, and from the Low Art Museum in Coral Gables, this is Art Loft's The Curator's Collection. Hi, art lovers. It's great to have you back. This week, Art Loft presents The Curator's Collection. The Curator's Collection is a series of monthly specials inviting South Florida arts innovators to curate episodes based on their artistic vision. Together, we review their favorite Art Loft profiles and discuss how those artists and performers are impacting the arts community. For this episode, we welcome Beaux-Art Director and Chief Curator at the Low Art Museum, Jill Deupi. Jill, thanks for joining us here on the Curator's Collection.
Thank you for having me. It's absolutely my pleasure to invite you into my home away from home here in the Crest Galleries at the Low Art Museum.
Well, speaking of home away from home, you've been here for 2 years now. What attracted you to the Low Museum?
The Low is a very, very special place. Founded in 1950, we are the oldest visual arts organization in Miami-Dade County and actually in the South Florida region. So we're now in our 66th year. We also have 19,000 objects and they are encyclopedic. So we span 5,000 years and we are truly global in our reach.
We'll now discuss our first selection, Attitudes and Latitudes. For this segment, we visited Arts Center South Florida just before they moved a few doors down on Miami Beach's Lincoln Road. In this collaborative exhibit, artists from Canada and South Florida literally allow nature to be their guides while preparing their contributions. Jill, why did this piece make an impression on you?
The thing that impressed me the most, I think, is that the exhibition speaks to the power of art as a universal language, as the ultimate communicator. And the exhibition was really, really wonderful in so far as it brought together Canadian artists with, as you know, Miami artists. And you could see through very, very different visual languages, visual idioms, they were speaking to many of the same themes. I think the pieces that stood out the most to me were the pairings. They were not intentional at first, but of course became intentional through the curatorial process of the horses that really are so different in terms of the media and their final manifestation, but also are pointing to a shared visual language. So again, I think it's really important to remember that art is such a wonderful communicator and that you don't need to speak the same language or come from the same geographic region to be able to have a very, very meaningful conversation between objects and ultimately between people.
Now we'll take a look at Attitudes and Latitudes.
This is an exhibition that came out of the research trip that I did about 2 years ago in Winnipeg, Canada. I was invited by a small yet very vibrant art organization based in Winnipeg called MAWA to go and spend about 5 or 6 days in the town and really familiarize with the local artists. They had a lot of studio visits set up for me and I gave a little presentation about my curatorial activity, talking about my exhibitions and sort of how I approach my curating. I started to kind of see a red thread that was interesting to me, which was really about the connection between the artist and the landscape. And I started thinking about artists who I had met here in Miami, some I had worked with, some I had just done studio visits. And I thought, well, wouldn't it be interesting to connect with artists in Miami whose work also is somehow connected to the landscape or has been inspired by nature, and see how these artists that are immersed in these very different landscapes deal with the nature around them.
It's saying something about this interaction, how these artists from Canada and artists from Miami come up with some kind of connection that it has been through nature. And that thing that is very self-explanatory. I don't think that you need to know really a lot of contemporary art. You have drawings, you have some 3D items and smaller sculptures, you have video. So I think that you easily see this contrast between one landscape and the other, and also the kind of materials used, sometimes very, very connected with the nature.
The one work that really triggered the whole exhibition was actually a series of sculptures which are here in the Richard Schott Gallery by Winnipeg-based artist Diana Thornycroft. And Diana has been mostly working with photography, but when we met, she had just started working on a series of sculptures. And they're essentially plastic horses, they're little plastic toys that she buys, and then she heats them in the oven, and once she said she just forgot about it, and so she ended up leaving the horse for too long and it started melting. So, you know, one of the legs went down, and so she looked at this beautiful horse that she loved the way it came and looked at it in this deformation, and I fell in love with them. I thought, you know, they were strong, they were powerful, they were beautiful, they were eerie and grotesque, and it was kind of like all these elements in, you know, in one sculpture. I was interested to create dialogues right between Miami and Winnipeg, as I said. So, for example, I had met this Miami-based artist named Andrew Nigan, and I saw he had some beautiful sculpture of horses from Carousel. And so I invited him to participate and create a beautiful installation, 924. And then there was a Canadian artist who was working with bees and placing scans on beehives. So the bees are actually becoming part of the art making process. And then last year I had seen Antonia Wright video, stunning video bee at her Sol Shua Spinello project, where she does Tai Chi moves with literally a swarm of bees on her.
At the time, our government was always very quick to go to war, and when we feel threatened, we always act aggressively. So I was supposed to talk to that, how just because we feel threatened doesn't mean we always have to act violently. So for the bees, it was if they didn't harm me, if I didn't harm them, they would not harm me.
Well, it's pretty unique, really, because I mean, I think that the most important thing is that the public, the general public, have access to the creative process of the artist. They get to know how the artist develop a work if they come 1 week and then they come in a month later, let's say. Then they get to see what the artist has been doing. This is something very exciting for the general public, and especially in this location where the high amount of visitors, usually they are not so familiar with contemporary art. So for them it's really a unique experience. First, get to see an exhibition in contemporary art where usually it's thought-provoking and we are trying to shake the crowds. And then we get to see also the environment where an artist is creating their work. Stay tuned for the new changes and the future ahead of the Art Center. And again, all the people and all the crowd is welcome to the 924 building here in Lincoln Road. We are not leaving Lincoln Road, and we are not going to stop providing and giving programs and supporting the artists and the art here in Miami.
Up next is Art Loft's coverage of Zhu Bing's Writing Between Heaven and Earth exhibition at the Patricia and Philip Frost Art Museum. Here, Bing unleashes iconography of his own creation that includes thousands of characters. Jill, why did you choose this piece?
As with the other exhibition that we just described, really it's about communication. And I think that it's so remarkable to imagine an iconic work of art with 4,000 characters that are completely indecipherable, even to the creator himself. It really speaks, I think, to not only the power of the visual image more powerful in this case than the written words, since the words don't exist, but also again to the power of art as a communicator, because we as visitors to the exhibition were able to interpret so much and take away so much from the sheer beauty, but also the power of the work, particularly when you began to understand that Zhu Bing was really interrogating Chinese tradition and all that it stands for.
I was amazed at the scope of the work because it took him 4 years to put all of that together.
An enormous investment of time. I think it spanned 2 years to do that central piece in particular, which really is remarkable to have that kind of discipline, but well worth it in the end for all of us.
Absolutely. Now, Zhu Bing's Writing Between Heaven and Earth exhibition at the Patricia and Philip Frost Art Museum.
My name is Li Duyi. I'm a professor at the Florida International University. I'm teaching Asian art. I am the curator for the Zhu Bing exhibition, Zhu Bing Writing Between Heaven and Earth. What we are looking at here in this room is a piece of artwork called the Square Word Calligraphy. We created this piece in a classroom setting to invite audience, you and me, to join us to help the artist to finish the art piece.
The calligraphy also look like Chinese, right? So, but when the people to do the calligraphy and to try to read it, actually the American audience, they can't read it. They can understand, oh, this is my language. In that moment, they really getting the really special experience.
This piece indicates his desire to combine Eastern-Western culture.
One of my favorite works in the exhibition is Book from the Sky. And that's a work that I am familiar with because I saw it many years ago at the Sackler up in Washington, D.C. And I didn't know what to expect, and I hadn't heard of Zhu Bing. Mind you, this was maybe 13 or so years ago. And I walked in, and my first thought was, this is absolutely awesome. It was there, it was shown with a very different background, sort of much darker. And here, our galleries are much lighter. But the ceilings are very high, they're cathedral-like. And this work truly complements the space and feeling of these large cathedral galleries. So when I started seeing it go up, I felt that same sense of breathlessness. This is a perfect installation for this gallery.
It took the artist 4 years to complete this piece. He invented 4,000 characters, which are incomprehensible, unreadable, even to the artist himself. He invented those characters. This piece, The Book from the Sky, shows his profound doubt about the language, about the Chinese tradition, about the tradition of Chinese language. Therefore, he invented those 4,000 words to push people to think and to make people feel equal, everybody. Chinese people don't understand the word of it. Westerners don't understand it. Nobody understands the word of it.
This exhibition of work by Zhu Bing is perhaps one of the most ambitious exhibitions that the Frost Art Museum has ever organized. It is a wonderful multi-installation exhibition exploring Zhu Bing's interest in calligraphic language.
The space is a beautiful space, but it's a little bit of a challenge how to use it, you know, yeah. But sometimes I like use the difficulty space. This way they can push the artist thinking is more farther. So just right now that my recent piece is a book from the ground. Yeah, they will show other space. Yeah. This book means everybody can read it because I wrote the book by icons, by symbols. The symbols and the icons not invented by itself. All the icons come from we collected, from magazines, from newspaper, from the email, from all over the world. Yeah, when I travel to anywhere, I always take the photo. Oh, I saw some icons, I just collected.
We are doing a lot of education programs in conjunction with this exhibition, and these will be listed on our website as well as in our e-blasts. One of them is based on Shubing's square word calligraphy, and we will invite our visitors to make their own square word calligraphy, and we will have an opportunity to teach that to students, to children, to adults, whoever shows up to our program.
This edition of Art Loft, the Curator's Collection, is being curated by Jill Deupi, Beaux Art Director and Chief Curator at the Lowe Art Museum. Jill's next selection originally aired early in season one. In fact, it was on our third show. It features the photography of Annie Leibovitz. Now, Leibovitz has been capturing iconic images for decades. Her photos have been featured on the cover of numerous editions of Vanity Fair, Vogue, and Rolling Stone magazine. And this is just a taste of her artistic reach. Jill, what about this trip to the Norton Museum interested you?
Part of it, frankly, has to do with the fact that it was Annie Leibovitz, who is an icon. I think that her art is incredible, not only for its technical polish, but also for the fact that she's able to create such penetrating portraits, psychological portraits of her sitters. And that's one of the things that also drew me to this exhibition. The fact that she herself says that it's very important to do your homework, which I think is very telling if an artist of her caliber is still talking about how you really do need to prepare. But also, I'm so impressed with her attraction to non-traditional photos, and of course the one that sticks in my mind is her famous portrait of Pele and his feet, the soccer player, because that was his feet that really made his career and was the focal point of his life and what defined him as not only as a human being, perhaps, but certainly as a superstar and someone in the constellation of sitters for Leibovitz.
And I like the fact that he didn't use just those iconic images when he curated the show, but he also went a little deeper and really looked at how her photography fell in line with the evolution of photography in general.
To be reminded that this is part of a much broader history of a field that, although it's still fairly young, photography that is, really does have a clear evolution, and of course we're nowhere near the end of that evolution at this point.
Let's now take a look at Annie Leibovitz at the Norton Museum of Art.
It's always a surprise to me. People don't really sort of take in that there's homework to be done. You know, you learn about the subject, you learn about what they do, you find out as much as you can about them, and it's always good to go in at this point in my life with an idea or a plan or something that you know you're going to do. And if something else happens, it's always important to sort of leave a window for spontaneity or something else might be able to happen. And if you're working with someone like the President of the United States, you better know what you're going to do for 15 minutes, yes. And you know, I've been doing this for over 40 years, so you know, the early work was all reportage, just you know, whatever happened. And you know, as things went on, doing the covers of Rolling Stone, you had to sort of set things up. You know, suddenly you had appointments with people, and you started, you know, I started to think about how I would take a picture, because you know, suddenly people would say, well, what do you want me to do? And so you had to start thinking about, you know, what you wanted to do. First of all, I love photography, and I'm a big fan of photography, and I admire in my portraiture, you know, I like to like people, and I like, you know, I admire people who do things well. But you know, so I like to come at the portrait with the idea of what the person does, and you know, like Baryshnikov is a great dancer, you know, and think that way, you know, rather than they're a celebrity. You know, I'd like to think about like what they do more than who they are. This again was Charlie Stenbeck's, you know, idea And it was interesting to me. He had an idea where he really wanted the subject looking straight at the camera, and he went through my work and found, you know, had a very clear idea about what he wanted to do.
Well, she was great. I mean, I think you saw today, you know, how sort of personable and forthcoming she is, and it was really a wonderful process. But going to her studio, sitting down with her, you know, it was really a lot of fun. You know, we spent like a half day together, just going through pictures, pinning Xeroxes up on her wall, and really just talking about this election. And but it was fun. I mean, I really was looking at sort of not just her work, but I was looking at her work, how it fits into the history of photography, and you know, looking at the other photographers that have dealt with portraiture. And you know, I just didn't respond to those sort of top 40 famous pictures that she's done. I really wanted to look at it sort of a quieter look, I guess maybe a more serious, less theatrical. And it's just a sort of a personal bias I have about photography. And that's the great thing about being a curator. You get to make decisions, and they're your decisions.
I don't think of this as an exhibit. It's an exhibit of an acquisition with Charlie curating it. And you know, we had our bits of we're a contention. You know, basically, I kind of like the sort of anti-portrait. You know, there I have a portrait of Pelé, the soccer player, and because he played as a young boy in the streets of São Paulo without any shoes, and his feet are all battered up, my portrait of Pelé is just his feet. And you know, that was not a portrait that Charlie would imagine in this collection. He wanted, he had a very specific idea, and we worked together, and we you know, came out with something. But we sort of came from, you know, opposing ends, and found a middle ground. And I find it it's a surprising set. You know, I really was looking at it in some way for the first time last night, and it doesn't have any of the blockbusters in it. It doesn't have, you know, like Keith Haring or John and Yoko or you know, any of those. But there's something very strong about the sense that the subject is pretty direct, straightforward. To this day, I'm always, you know, questioning what I have and if it's good enough, and if I could have done this and I could have done that. I'm always my worst, you know, critic and judge, because you know, I always wish it was better, you know. So it's, you know, I probably don't know for sure. Sometimes with time and looking back at something, it's better than you imagine, and most of the times it's worse than you imagined.
Thanks so much for joining us for Art Loft, the Curator's Collection. And a special thanks goes to our guest curator, Jill Deupi, the Beaux-Arts Director and Chief Curator at the Lowe Art Museum. Jill, thanks so much for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
Do you have anything special our viewers should know about that's coming up here at the Lowe?
We are very excited about our fall exhibition program. I will share with you highlights from September. We opened Titus Kafar's incredible Vesper project and installation here at the museum on Thursday, September 8th, 7 p.m., and Titus will be here for a gallery talk and reception. And just a few weeks later, we have Donald Sultan's The Disaster Paintings that will be opening, and once again, Donald will be here. Those events are open to the public, so we hope to see your viewers there.
Thank you, Jill. For more information about those events and the Lowe Art Museum, visit lowemuseum.org. I'm Caitlin James, reminding you to stay creative. See you next time on Art Loft's The Curator's Collection. Bye. All right, quiet folks, no walking, no talking, no showing your teeth. Jill, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you for having me. It's absolutely my pleasure.
Thank you. I don't know what to say next time. I forgot. Sorry.
Again, the global cultures.
Yeah. Outstanding. Jill's next selection. That was weird. Jill's next selection. Now you must be shot.
Now you must be caned.
Thanks so much for joining us, Jill.
Thank you for
Wait.
Having me.
Did I call you Jane earlier? I'm Kaylin James with Jill Deupi, sending, damn it to hell. I don't know what this is. Rap battle, what? My name is Kaylin, and I can say I'm on Art Loft, filming today, and I got mad skills, and I get ill. If you want to pay me, just pay my bills. Let that be all.
Funding for Art Loft was made possible by...
In the Florida Keys and Key West, every night is a spectacular show. And every day is another masterpiece.
This project is sponsored in part by the Department of State, Division of Cultural Affairs, the Florida Council of Arts and Culture, and the State of Florida. With the support of the Miami-Dade County Department of Cultural Affairs and the Cultural Affairs Council, the Miami-Dade County Mayor, and the Board of County Commissioners. With the support of the City of Coral Gables.